Hey, y'all, welcome back. Welcome back. Awesome. And as Pastor said there, we have a serious job, don't we? Because sometimes you're the last line of defense before someone dies and goes to hell. Think about that. I had some EMTs hear me speak, and they were catching it. They're soul winners. And they said, wait a minute. As EMTs, many times we're the last people they will chat with before they meet God. And they would share their faith with people that would get into the ambulances and stuff like that. They were bold like doing this. So think about the importance of our responsibility to do that, okay? I'm gonna speak a little fast tonight. This is actually a 3-hour seminar we do around the country. We're gonna do it in 2, and I'm gonna do it faster than that, so we have a good question answer time at the end, okay? So think about the questions you wanna ask me, how to witness to a certain type of person, maybe a question you're afraid to get, or maybe a question you had you didn't know how to answer maybe today, at lunch today, and let's help break down some of those questions for you and do that, okay? And this is called Reaching the Lost Now. I just want to pray as well. Father, thank you so much for all the stuff you taught me through the years. And as Father, as the people look at me many times, they think, you know, I'm just bold, I talk to everybody. But they forget 20 years ago, I never talked to one person about your son, Jesus Christ. But as you worked on my heart, as I read the Bible, I understood the importance of going out witnessing. Father, I had to talk to the very first person 20 years ago. One became two. 2 became 3, and I've never been the same since then. So Father, for many of us, we just need to get started, because Father, Satan has many Christians where he wants them. He's got them stopped. But if a Christian ever gets started, there's the strong possibility they're never gonna stop. And that's the fear of the enemy, that if a Christian gets started. Father, give us a good push today to get us started down the road of being soul winners that you want us to be all the days of our lives. Because we only have as Pastor was talking this morning, Wayne, we just got a short time left. There can't be a long time left. We need to use our time wisely, redeeming the time. Have your way during this time, Father. We ask it in the great name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen, amen. Okay? All right, this talk is called Reaching the Lost Now. So the first, I'm going to give you 3 points, and then we'll just do some question and answer. Reaching the Lost Now. The first part is a want to. If you have a want to, the rest is simple. Now, we actually tied that in this morning. The first B was for what? Burden. If you have the burden for your waiter and waitress, that's okay. I had a guy email me. He heard me speak at something. They walked into a convenience store, and he saw these two guys working the convenience store, and they walked in. They knew they were supposed to talk with them, and they walked out, and they didn't do it. And they emailed me, said, we had these two guys there, and we didn't even witness them. And you would have witnessed them. I emailed back, don't beat yourself up. I said, 2 weeks ago, you would have walked into the same convenience store, got your Mountain Dew and beef jerky. You wouldn't even thought about those two guys. Now you just walked in there, and now you thought about those two guys, okay? Your next step is you're gonna talk to those two guys next time. See, aren't they on the right road? They're on the right road, okay? So don't walk out of this beating yourself up. Does that make sense? Okay, don't beat yourself up. I don't care. I don't care how you finish the race. I don't care if you're sitting here 50 years old, you've never shared your faith before. I could care less about that. When you grab the plow, you can't look what? Because as soon as you do, your hands move. And now you don't have the straight line to plant your seed anymore. Forget that. Long gone. Yesterday's long gone. I should have been bolder in the Atlanta airport. I wasn't. I don't worry about it. Today's the new day. I live today. Okay? I'm not worried about being in the Indianapolis airport tomorrow, who I get to witness to. I may not make it to tomorrow. I've got to worry about today first. Okay? Finish today outright, and I'll worry about tomorrow when I walk into tomorrow. Does that make sense? Okay, so the first one's a want to. Okay? Grab your Bibles. I'm going to bounce through a bunch of scriptures. So be ready to bounce through. We're about to open it, so be what? Be careful. Life-changing book, right? Who was in the first service today? Who was in the first service? Remember when I told the story of the hostess I met at BJ's, Kayla? She came to the second service. Yeah, she came to the second service. She came up, we just had lunch, actually, her and her current boyfriend. And boyfriend really loves the Lord. Had an interesting conversation over lunch. But remember I told you her dad had passed away. And as a believer, and we were talking about it at lunch, and boy, she was still, you know, crying at the table. She just loved her dad. They were just one of those real tight, you know, father-daughter things. But we started talking about the importance of just knowing your dad and where dad's at right now. Well, now you can do something, Kayla, your dad can't do. You can talk to lost people, Kayla, and your dad can't do that right now, okay? But she actually came to the second service. It was really cool. We just had a good time together. But again, if I go to that BJ's 2 years ago and I don't talk to her when I walk in, I still go to heaven. I believe in Jesus. Do you see what I would have missed out on? okay? I missed out on her that day to learn about her family, her dad, have lunch with her and all that stuff. So that's why we want to step out and do it, okay? So grab your Bibles. And she started reading the Bible. That's really what flipped rocks. Her dad kept teaching her scriptures, and then she would get there and look them up herself, okay? So be careful. Okay, grab your Bibles. Go to Mark 16. We're going to bounce around a bunch of scriptures here. So I have to have the want to. Mark 16, Matthew, Mark. Mark 16, last chapter of Mark. And go to verse 15. Mark 16. And I'll get there one day. 15. It was making a little noise. Thank you there. Mark 16, 15, and it says, and he said unto them, who's he? Jesus. So do we pay attention when Jesus speaks? Yes. Now remember, he wrote the whole Bible. So be careful. If you have a red letter Bible, you just want to pay attention to just the red letters. He wrote the whole shooting match. Okay, so you want to understand. And he said, go ye into all the world. Go means do not stay, means get up and go. Go to BJ's. Go to the mall. Some of my friends drove up here 2 years ago when you had the Super Bowl. So my friends drove up here and they handed out gospel tracts downtown Indiana and talked to lost people about Jesus Christ. Some of my friends did more work during the Super Bowl for Jesus Christ than you did, and it's your city. That's wrong. That's wrong. It's your town. When the Final Four came to Atlanta last year, we were on the streets for Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. Okay, I was so tired by Monday evening, I was tired, okay? I was just tired. Hannah was talking to people. Trey Burke, the point guard for Michigan, I got to talk to his mom on the streets. This one Jewish kid from University of Michigan, he's going for dentistry school. I talked to him twice. He came up to me on Monday the second time to talk some more, okay? So I have all these stories I still remember from the Final Four. Well, you guys get the Final Four all the time up here in Indy, so look for events where you can go to them. Don't expect lost people to always show up here. I grew up Roman Catholic, and in Roman Catholicism, they taught you don't go into anything non-Catholic. You were taught that as a kid. Ah, now I know why. There was truth in that other building over there, and I needed the truth. And they told me, don't go there, because this is our group right here, okay? So they may not walk in here. They may not come to your new sanctuary. They may not come on Friends Day, but they will go to lunch with you when you invite them to work at 12 noon tomorrow, okay? And they will talk with you when you throw a question across the table tomorrow, okay? So again, go to them, into all the world, okay, and preach the gospel. The word preach isn't the word preacher. That's not what the word is. The word preach means to speak. Open up your mouth, talk. Okay? Can all of us do that? Yes or no? Yep, all of us can do that, okay? The gospel. What's the word gospel mean? Good news, okay? Let's be honest. This is really great news, if you get down to it. It really left good news a long time ago. This is great news. I deserve to go to hell for all of eternity for the wicked things I have done against a holy, righteous God who is absolutely unconditionally in love with me. And yet, because of his son, I get to go to heaven and hang out with him, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost for all of eternity. Are you kidding me? You have hit the jackpot, the lottery, times a gazillion. That's good. That's great news, right? By the way, if you have great good news, do you tell people good news? Okay, you ladies here, if you're pregnant, you're about to have your first child, but we put a law in that you couldn't tell anybody about your baby for 6 months after you had your child. You had to be quiet, couldn't tell anyone about the child you just birthed, okay? So ladies, that's the law in Indiana, you can't tell anybody about your new baby, okay? Would any of you ladies maybe, oh gosh, I don't know, break the law? of course, you just said, right? Because see, you have good news. Johnny's been in there 9 months. Johnny's finally out, okay? I've got great news. Look at this baby. And you want to tell what? Everybody. I mean, you'll put pink balloons and blue balloons and storks in your yard. You want to tell everybody. There's a story in Paradise where this Catholic gentleman, his wife gets saved. And she got saved because there were some ladies in the neighborhood who had a Bible study for new mothers, okay? So the mothers would go over there and they would help them learn about being mamas and stuff like that. And then they teach the scriptures. And that lady got saved and she witnesses to her husband in the book Paradise. Well, guess what? That lady in the book is my sister. She wasn't saved. She had her first baby. She knew instantly there was a God. Instantly. She didn't know who it was. Okay, but she knew there was a God. She joins a MOPS group, Mothers of Preschool or something like that. She joins the group, starts getting there. They give her scripture. She does research study. And my sister gets saved a couple years later. Okay, so that lady in the book is actually my sister. That actually really happened to her, okay? So think about that. You have great news. Let's tell somebody great news, okay? The gospel to every creature. Why every creature? Because every person needs Jesus Christ, right? Now be careful of some translations. I know it's the NIV will say all creation. Careful with that, because we're getting very new agey here at the end before the return of Jesus Christ. The worship of animals and things here, right? Romans 1 says they worship the creation and not the creator, okay? I got to witness to Tony La Russa, the manager of the St. Louis Cardinals one time, and everything to him was animals, animals, animals. He has 65 pets, him and his wife. They get from Animal Rescue. All of his charitable work is for animal rescue things. Everything was creation, creation, creation. And he's missed the creator, okay, at the end there. And even you watched when he won the World Series this last year in St. Louis, when he got up to speak, he mentioned the rally squirrels that happened in St. Louis, the Clydesdale horses brought him in, and then the cards, with the, they call them birds on the bat, because there's two cardinals on the baseball bat. All he wanted to mention was animals. It was a dead giveaway, if you know anything about him. It was a dead giveaway. Animals, animals, animals. Ooh, I know who made those animals. And when you want to get to know the creator who made those cardinals and Clydesdales, yes, you would. We want to share him as well to people, okay? Go to Matthew 4. Matthew 4. Matthew 4, verse 19. Let's go back to 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach, speak, talk, to say what? Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Now, we hit this really, really hard in Paradise and in The Watchman as well. Talk about repentance with people. Because what you have to understand is some people just want a get out of hell free card, okay? To say some prayer when you're 13 or 30. Hopefully when you die, you get to show Jesus this get out of hell free card and go to heaven for all of eternity. You have to understand biblical salvation. Biblical salvation is not drink beer, use drugs, have sex, cheat on tests, disobey your parents, get saved. Drink beer, use drugs, have sex, cheat on tests, disobey your parents. That's not biblical salvation at all. When someone in the Bible gets saved, when Jesus Christ moves into a life, that life changes, correct? Oh, it changes, okay, big time, okay? There's a before and after picture. I got saved at 25, so when I go back to high school reunions, my buddies look at me and say, dude, you're so different, because dude's different, okay? You should be different, right? Now, can you be tempted with all those things once you're saved? Oh yeah, Satan knows what buttons to push on you, okay? But don't think it's just say some prayer, okay, and then you can do whatever you want afterwards. Does that make sense? That's kind of an American Christianity, but you really don't see it at different places around the world. But you want to be careful when you talk to people. Make sure you talk about repentance with people, and I'll explain that a little bit later as well. But talk repentance. And all repentance means is a change of mind that leads to a change of action. Okay, it's a U-turn. I talked about one of my books. It's just doing a U-turn. So if I struggle with alcohol and all my friends are going to a keg party, I don't need to go to the keg party. I need to do a U-turn and go this direction. Correct? I don't need to go that direction. So that's all is a change of mind. I ask people, do you want a different life? If their answer is no, then today's not the day to get saved. If you don't even know your life is repulsive to God, you still need to do some more research in here and study this. Does that make sense? Okay. So talk repentance. When you study the New Testament all the way front to back, repentance is a huge topic in the New Testament that we don't talk much in the American church today. Okay. So make sure you talk that with them. Verse 19, and he saith, unto them, he's speaking, Jesus speaking, come follow me and I'll make you a great student. Okay, let me try again, I'm from the South. Come follow me and I'll make you a great athlete. Come follow me and make sure your car wins today in the Daytona 500. Come follow me and I'll make sure you're a millionaire even when the economy's bad in America. He says, come follow me and I'll make you what? Fishers of men. Why? It's the highest call in life. There is no higher call than you walking out here and telling a lost person about Jesus Christ. And the moment you did that today, or the moment you do that tonight, the moment you do that tomorrow, you're doing something Peter can't do right now. You're doing something Paul can't do right now. You're doing something Thomas can't do right now. You're doing something John Wesley can't do right now. Charles Spurgeon can't do right now. But you know what? They wish they could. because now they know. See, they're past the point of believing because they met Jesus Christ the day they died. They know now. They know he's the right answer, okay? But they can't do what we're doing today. Does that make sense? That means how serious this job is we have as believers, okay? And it's Hebrews 11. It's the Hall of Fame of Faith job. They've handed the baton to us to keep it going of reaching a world for Jesus Christ. If you watch the Summer Olympics, someone hands you a baton, and many times the person does what? They drop it. You know, sometimes we've dropped a baton. We've been looking back instead of looking forward, okay? If you drop the baton, that's okay. If you haven't been witnessing lately, that's okay. Reach down and what? Pick up the baton. Now, again, you may not win the gold medal, but that's not what your goal is. It doesn't matter what your medal is, okay? Your goal is how do you finish for Jesus Christ? A lot of people, the thief on the cross, that's where we got the title from paradise for. Would you remember when you come to your kingdom? And today you shall be with me in paradise, okay? Because there's a bunch of false paradises. That's the real paradise. And I was wrestling with that story one day, and that's part of the theme of the whole book. I thought one day, I said, who came to his funeral? He had done something so bad that he got nailed to a cross, okay? And he was going to die. Who came to his funeral, okay? Were his buddies there? Was his thieving friends there? Or were they long gone? Who came to his funeral, okay? If they didn't come to his funeral, they missed out on a wild ending, didn't they? Oh, yeah, because he's in heaven. He's in paradise now. Remember you come to your kingdom? And today you shall be with me in paradise. And I had a lady walk to me one time. She said, I'm a mother. I said, okay. She said, I'd be at my son's funeral. She said, I would have been there. So, you know, think mom was probably there, okay? But whoever went there saw a wonderful ending for him, correct? Think about that. So don't write certain people off. Remember I told you my friend died, Brother Woody died last Monday. Went there a week before. Beautiful sunny day. I just started eating again. And I just was walking outside in Florida. A guy walks over. Well, he's from across the street. So I start talking to him, give him a couple of my books. I go in the house with Brother Woody's wife. The two people come across who are living in a trailer in the same house, Ed and the lady he's about to marry in a couple of days. We start talking, witness to them, gave them two of my books, and I had to go to the nursing home. Mrs. Woody, we were talking this week on the phone. She said, oh, Mark, you know those people from across the street? I said, yeah. She said, both of them are reading the books. The man who lives there knocked on my door, said, we are reading these books and they are hammering us. Okay, she said, don't worry about that. Make sure your heart is open to Jesus Christ. She comes right at you. She doesn't play. She's 79. She just comes right at you, okay? The other guy, then he said, you know the guy that's getting married? He said, yeah, a year ago, you wouldn't even recognize him. A total drunk. Total drunk. He was in his 60s, okay? And he gave up alcohol. Hey, you can give up alcohol and still die and go to hell, correct? Yes, you can, okay? He was reading Paradise, and it is flipping him out, okay? Because we talked about what biblical salvation was when he was sitting there, okay? Again, just seeing that that's what we're here for, okay? The thief on the cross can't talk to lost people anymore. He had it his time. We have our section of time, but we need to make sure we're handing baton to, what, the people behind us. I had a boy walk up to me at a camp one time. I was giving a talk there, and he said, sir, he said, you're the first person I've ever heard speak on evangelism that actually had stories to tell. Think about that. Because many people will speak from, but if you don't have stories to tell, that probably implies you don't do it. But one of the things you'll always remember are the stories that I tell. Right? You'll remember that guy, his wife was shot and killed by the stalker 2 years ago. You'll always remember that story because it just sticks in your head. Then he looked and he said, oh, he said, by the way, I'm a preacher's kid. So what he's saying is if his dad ever speaks on evangelism, his dad doesn't what? Doesn't do it, if he even talks on it. Okay, listen, we're dropping the baton. Some of you men need to take your sons out to Greenwood Mall over here and just walk around and talk with people. They need to see, I ask boys all the time, have you ever seen your father one-on-one talk to a lost person about Jesus Christ? Dad, you'd be stunned at the answers you get from your kids. Okay, that's okay. Today's a new day, right? If I drop the baton, do what? Pick it up. Hand it correctly to the kids coming behind you, then they can hand it to the next group, the next. Does that make sense? Okay, so think about that. Go to Luke 16. Now, Luke 16 is very famous for the story of Luke 16, of rich man and Lazarus. Okay, so it's Luke 16, 19 through 31. Now, it's such a powerful story that it's a whole chapter in the Watchman. I just did a whole chapter on Luke 16, 19 through 31, because it just impacts me so much. But now, as soon as I said story, that implies what? That can imply what? Not true, okay? I had a lady walk up to me one time in Iowa. I was doing this talk, and she handed me a little note afterwards. I read the note. She said, you know, when you use the word story, it can imply not true. So you may want to use the word account instead, because it's the account of rich man and Lazarus. So it doesn't imply a story, it implies something as being true. Does she have a good point, yes or no? Hammered me, okay? Good thing for your notes, I always tell people all the time, always stay teachable. Always stay teachable, okay? The day you're not teachable is the day your pride has taken over and you're about to do a face plant somewhere. Okay, you're about to go face down. God's going to drop you, okay? Always stay teachable. Now, careful, that doesn't mean you're teachable into false doctrine, okay? I had a guy email me earlier or late last year, and he said, why can't you be more like Billy Graham, who was more ecumenical when it came to Catholics? Because if you don't know anything about Billy Graham and his crusades would have priests up on the dais up here, and when you turned in your decision card, if you put on there you grew up Roman Catholic, he would take the decision cards, give them to the local Catholic priest so they could do the follow-up with you. Okay? If you didn't know that about Billy Graham, he did that for decades. Excuse me. No. I spent 25 years in Catholicism. I didn't hear the gospel once in 25 years of being in the Catholic Church and going to Mass. Not once. I heard the gospel and I read the Bible and I started going to Protestant churches when I finally heard the gospel and stuff. You don't give that. You want to get the people out of that. But he was extremely ecumenical. Okay, and the guy emailed me, said, why can't you be more teachable like Billy Graham was? And he said, I said, no, I'm teachable. I'm just not teachable into false doctrine. I'm a former Roman Catholic, I told the guy. I understand what the Roman Catholics in their literature, they have, I believe it's 7 or 9. They have 7 different ways to get rid of your sins. 7. When you're baptized as a baby, all your sins are cleansed away. When you confess your sins to a priest, they're all forgiven. When you take the Eucharist, because they don't believe, they believe in what's called transubstantiation. Do you know the high point of a Catholic Mass is not preaching the word, the homily, it's communion. What they do up here is they take the bread and wine, they call Jesus back down on the altar, he's re-crucified on the altar, and the bread and wine become the actual body and blood of Jesus Christ. It's called transubstantiation. So when you take the piece of bread, you're actually eating a piece of Jesus is what it is, okay? Well, wait a minute. That would make sense, I guess, if it's Jesus and he could cleanse me of the sin. But wait, what if I go with what the Bible says when the Bible says, do this in remembrance of me, okay? See, if it's just a remembrance of him, then it can't be him. Does that make sense? At the Last Supper, Jesus is holding the bread and the wine. So it can't be him. He's actually physically holding it, okay? So there's all these, wait a minute, I read the Bible one time. I could only find one way to get rid of your sins. That's that beautiful cross right there, the wondrous cross that we've got, okay? That's why we got to keep preaching. What did Paul say? Preach Christ crucified. Preach Christ crucified, 1 Corinthians 15. Why? Because that's the whole turning point. All of time changed on the life of Jesus, B.C. to A.D. All of time changed on this man. I have to just find out 2 simple things. Was the cross real? And then was the resurrection real? That's the only things I got to find out. Okay, and in the book Paradise, we go through the resurrection heavy, tons of evidence for the resurrection, because that's the big deal. If he rose from the dead, you can believe exactly what he says. Now, careful, because we know with the Antichrist, he's going to be wounded in the head, and he's going to rise back up. It's going to be a false resurrection. My aunt, she's not saved yet, but she worked in the casinos in Colorado. When she's working in the casinos, she'd count the money at night. Every now and then, they'd slip in a counterfeit $100 bill or slip in a counterfeit $50 bill, and you had to be able to find it and put it to the side. So they would test that. But what they would never let you do is play with the counterfeit money. Because if you played with the counterfeit money, your fingertips would get desensitized, and then you couldn't know the real counterfeit when you were going through the money. Does that make sense? Yeah, see, once I know the real resurrection, I can find every false resurrection out there. You see, once I know the right way to get to heaven, how many ways? One? one way. Then when people tell me there's multiple paths to get to the same place, guess what? I know that's a false answer to the question. You see, so I know to the real. Where do you get the real from? Right here. Got to know this book. T-E-T. Test everything and test everybody in the end of days here. Test everything. Test everybody. T-E-T. But you test them against what? The Word of God. Okay? So go to Luke 16. Now, we know this isn't a story because it actually uses real names. Lazarus, Abraham and stuff. Okay, so go to 25. And Abraham said, Son, remember, in thou lifetime receivest thy good things, likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Is hell a place of torment, yes or no? Yes, this isn't a game. Isn't a game. I had a student at the University of Georgia tell me one time, it's okay if I go to hell. There's a bunch of really good bands there. Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, Kurt Cobain. No, it's not a game. You heard this one, you heard people call it a Christless eternity. Have you heard that one before? Christless eternity. Yeah, it's a very bad statement for hell, because remember, it says in the book of Revelation that the wrath of the Lamb will be upon them. Who's the Lamb? Jesus Christ. See, what you do if you go to hell, you reject the benevolent side of God, you reject the merciful side of God, and you get the wrathful side of God. So be careful. The world today is really kind of mocking the hell argument. They're mocking it big time. Again, we can do that in question and answer time about that. But again, it's a place of torment, not a joke. Okay, 26. And beside all this, if that wasn't enough, between us and there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from there. So you have heaven, hell. Many people think this is Abraham's bosom, which is a little different than the final heaven or hell. But you have the people in the top, people in the bottom of Abraham's bosom, and they can actually see each other. Okay? And the people in heaven, they don't want to bring a tip of water to these people's tongue. They want to do what? Get them what? Out of there, and they can't. That's what you do here. Stop people from going there. The people in hell, they don't want a tip of water. They want what? Out, and they can't. It's an eternal sentence that is not commuted. Okay? I told my brother Mike on the phone one day, I said, Mike, you can die and go to hell over my dead body. Okay? I said, Mike, I'm going to pray whatever it takes for God to get your attention, God will get your attention. Mike, you have a 9-year-old daughter. She's 21 now. So I said this to my brother 12 years ago. And I said, Mike, I'll pray. And if it means something happens to your daughter to get your full and complete attention for Jesus Christ, be rest assured your soul is that important to God, Mike. Okay? Pretty strong conversation to have with your older brother. Okay? I care about the soul of my older brother. Okay? About 6 months ago, someone in Tampa, Florida took my brother out to lunch and shared Jesus Christ with him over a lunch table. Okay? My brother flipped out. He started calling all his friends that he knew or thought were Christians. Hey, did you set me up with that person to take me out? Did you set me up? He kept wondering, what is going on, okay? And because God is trying to get Mike's attention. I was just preaching in Tampa a couple weeks ago. And my brother didn't come. He was going to the beach with his current girlfriend, okay? See, you can run away from this all the time. My brothers won't read my books. Won't touch them. That's actually okay. Because they know if they ever open up, they're going to get hammered with truth. Okay, they know it. They know it. They're not rejecting me. This has nothing to do with me. They hate God. They hate Jesus Christ. That's what it really is. So again, when you get rejected, sometimes remember, their hatred really isn't for us. Their hatred's against a God that says, you must come to me on my terms, or you are going nowhere where you think you're going. Okay, so again, that's why we keep pointing to the cross and let your argument be with him. He can handle it all. He's the God of the universe, okay? 27, there he would say, then he said, I pray thee, it means I beg thee, therefore, Father, thou wouldest send him to my father's house. Excuse me? You're in hell and you're thinking about your father's house? That means your memory works, right? Your senses don't disappear. Remember last time I was here, I told you all those near-death experience stories about people who saw heaven, but the 31 people I met who saw hell, I put almost all those stories in the Paradise book, and people are flipping on that section. Your memory works in hell. You remember your family, your house, remember the things you did, okay? People who have gone to the hell experience and come back 20 years later, they still tell me the screams that they heard from people. They can't get the screams out of their head. It was so intense and agony. I had a lost person. He said it was weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. I had a lost person describe the screams he heard one time in hell that way, okay? It's not a game. This is serious business. But what does he remember his father's house? 28, for I have five brethren that he may also come unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Look at this. This guy is in hell, and now he's concerned about his five brethren, okay? Now, you don't even know the relationship. They might have fought, might have hated each other, might have argued over dad's inheritance. You don't know, but all of a sudden you're in hell and you're caring about one thing, that my, please send people to my five brethren. Don't you dare let them come to this place of torment. Okay, think about that. Real simple. If you don't want to listen to Pastor Wayne and me telling you go share your faith in Jesus Christ, if you don't want to listen to Jesus when he says go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, would you at least listen to people from hell screaming today, please go talk to my five brethren. Don't you dare let them come to this place of torment. Would you listen to somebody before it's all said and done? See, once you have the want to, the rest is really simple, okay? So number one's want to. Number two is afraid to. So number one's want to. Number two is afraid to, okay? So raise some hands up. We're going to do more classroom type stuff. I was a school teacher back in the day. So raise some hands up. What holds you back from just walking out those doors and sharing Jesus Christ with every single person you meet, okay? Let's see if we can chop some of these arguments. So pop some hands up. What holds you back from just talking with people and getting into conversation? What is it? Embarrassed what way? Okay, so I'm gonna look foolish if I can't answer a certain question or something like that, okay? Okay, go to Galatians 1. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians. Galatians 1. Which is just an amazing chapter in the Bible. But go to verse 10. Galatians 1, the great stuff before it leads into 10, but 10 says, for do I now persuade men or who? God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. He's saying here, you have a choice to make. Okay, you're either going to please God with your life or you're going to please men with your life, but you can't do both. That's what he's saying here, okay? Make a choice. If you want to please people with your life, go for it. Guarantee you, you'll never get a pat on the back saying, well done, my good and faithful servant, when you die. If you want to please God with your life, go for it. But I will guarantee you, everybody on planet Earth ain't going to like you. Not going to like you. You have to make a choice who you want the thumbs up from. If you want thumbs up from people, just keep living a life that pleases people, okay? If you're not worried about that, live a life that pleases God and do that. Okay, now go back to John 12. Because you almost get the exact same thing in the Gospel of John. Because everybody worries, how do I look in someone else's eye? It's a big issue that people wrestle with. John 12. Do you remember when we were younger and remember the old Keeping Up with the Joneses, you always wanted to, you know, had what other people had and stuff like that. And I was young and I was like, yeah, where people thought me? I said, I can't wait to get older so I don't have to worry about this. Okay, now there's older people. Do we still worry about that back in the day? Yeah, we still worry about other people. It never went away. And I was always wrestling with that as a young kid and now I got older. It's like, it still doesn't go away. The only way it goes away is when I'm walking so close to that cross that I just don't worry what people think about me. You just reach that point of freedom in life. So go to John 12, 42. Nevertheless, among the chief rulers, also many believed on him, but because of the Pharisees, other people, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. Okay, now, when a Jewish person, their church is called a synagogue. Now, a synagogue is very different than an evangelical church of today. And a synagogue, it was your business contacts, it was your social contacts, and it was your worship connection to God. So if you got kicked out of the synagogue, there was a heavy penalty to pay. Very heavy penalty. Very, very different here because you can just go to the next church, right, and do that. So a very different penalty. A friend of mine up in Indiana, Merrillville, something like that. She has me speak up there a bunch, and she loves the Jews. She has a heart for Jewish people. Once a year, she goes to Israel for a month just to witness to Jewish people. Just has a heart for the Jews, okay? She told me she will meet rabbis that will tell her, hey, I've committed my life to Yeshua. Now, Yeshua is Jesus, okay? I've committed my life to Yeshua, but I haven't come out yet and told everybody, okay? Now, There's two things here. Sometimes I'll tell her, well, the Lord hasn't told me to come out yet. Okay, now, first of all, I have a question for you on one thing. So first of all, many times they won't come out because they know it's going to cost them something. It's going to cost them a very high position in the community. Rabbis are way, way up there. Okay? Careful when people sometimes say, the Lord told me to tell you. I get that one every now and then. Because I go, well, why didn't he just tell me? Okay? Be careful of that one. The Lord has told me not to come out yet. Where? How can you back that up with the Bible? Where in the Bible does it tell you to shut up about Jesus Christ? I'm having a hard time with that one. Okay, that's a lot of times you are putting your agenda upon God. Does that make sense what I'm saying? Yeah, you can take your agenda into prayer, right? And think God's putting a stamp of approval on that. You really can. It can be real dangerous to do that. I was doing a radio show the other day, and I said, it's really simple. God wants us to speak up, and Satan wants us to shut up. God wants us to speak up. Satan wants us to shut up. Question is, who's going to win the argument? That's all it comes down to. God wanted me to speak up at a restaurant today, or I could have gone there and shut up. I'm still going to heaven because I believe in Jesus Christ, but I would have missed out on a pretty couple cool things that happened at the restaurant today. Okay, so again, but 42, but remember what we told you last time. When you read a verse in the Bible, don't read a verse, read verses, plural. Don't read a text, read a context. Okay, watch what 43 says. For they love the praise of who? Men more than the praise of who? God. You have to make a choice. You're either going to please God with your life or please men with your life. And either way, not everybody's going to like it, either decision you choose anyways, okay? So again, choose to please God with your life. Don't worry what everybody thinks about you. My father took my Paradise book. He reads all my books. He's not saved yet. And he had it sitting next to his chair in the back by the TV, and he reads back there. And I went off on a trip, and I came back, and I didn't see the book there. I said, Dad, how are you liking Paradise? He kind of mumbled. I said, Dad, how do you like Paradise? He said, I threw it in the trash can. I said, really, Dad? I said, why'd you do that, Dad? He said, because your attacks on Catholicism. One of the characters is Catholic in there, and he's asking all these questions. What's true? Is it what my wife is saying who got saved, the Bible, or the Catholic doctrines? We have a really good give and take. It's really fun. Great book for Catholics. Perfect. And he took it, and he took my book, and he zinged it into the trash can. Well, one that proves it's a good book. Absolute proof it's a good book. Why? It brought him to the point of conviction. Yeah. So that wasn't all bad what Dad did, okay? But when he picked me up to one of the times to go to the emergency room, every time he picked me up, I had a case of books with me because it was mission trip to the hospital. And so we were sitting in the emergency room. I said, Dad, I brought my little Nook thing over there. Why don't you just pick it up and read while you're waiting on me? Well, my whole Nook is the Bible or Christian books. That's all that's on my Nook. So I knew if he popped it on, he must have misunderstood me. He picked up a Paradise book. The one he threw in the trash can, and started sitting there reading it right in front of me, okay? I don't know if he forgot that's what it was or what, but he was just reading it there. So again, God can still reach out to people and do that, okay? Making the most. So again, I can't worry what everybody thinks about me. But once you're past that, don't get arrogant about that. You can arrogantly run over people in life, okay? You're just freedom. You shall be free and free indeed, okay? You have freedom on that side when you're just trying to please God with that. But don't be rough about that. Some people can take that the wrong way, and then I can just bulldoze anybody as I run over them because God, you know, everything's for God in that. So just be careful how you do that. Okay, hands up. What holds us back from just talking to everybody we meet when we walk out? So pop some hands up. What holds us back? Yes, ma'am. Fear of rejection. Do you know every survey on witnessing, the number one thing is fear of rejection. It's the number one thing. What if they reject who? Me. So it's all coming back to who? Me. The whole gospel is not about me. It's about him. See, again, that's the premise of that is a very interesting premise. So we're worried, again, how I look in people's eyes, okay? When you get down to it, again, they're rejecting him. So when they reject him, shouldn't that hurt my heart more that they really hate our God and Savior? Yeah, I'll go through that in just a second, but that's the biggest one you get is the fear of rejection. So how do you handle that? We'll show you in a second how to do that, okay? Hands up. What holds us back from talking with anybody when we walk out the doors? What holds us back? Yes, ma'am. Yeah, good question. Time. Think about that for a second, that I can be so busy that you can come back here next Sunday and some of you will talk to zero people about Jesus Christ in 7 days. Okay? So a couple things on that. One, set a goal for yourself. Okay? So don't make it your goal to talk to all in Indianapolis by Thursday afternoon at 3. Okay? Don't make that your goal. A buddy of mine, his goal is to talk to 10 people a week about Jesus Christ. 10. He just keeps it simple. Nice, simple goal. Okay? So he works with the youth at his church. So every Sunday, the youth ask him, Mr. Furcheck, how many people did you talk to this week? They ask him every Sunday. So it puts him on the spot, doesn't it? He said, good question. I got to 6 this week. Okay, good job, Mr. Furcheck. Next week, I got 12 this week. I talked to 12 different people. Okay, so again, a lot of us are goal-oriented. So just put a simple goal. Talk to 10 people a week about spiritual matters. Keep it simple. Not a too huge goal that you can't accomplish. Another good thing to do is put something on your schedule that's part of your schedule that you're going to do all the time. Okay? So I was reading a book on witnessing, and this guy, they go door-to-door witnessing every single Monday night. Okay? It's just on his schedule. I have a buddy of mine, he goes to a flea market every single Saturday morning up in Pittsburgh. He goes to the same flea market, walks around, talks to people every single Saturday. So it's part of your schedule. Does that make sense? Now, it doesn't work for me because I travel so much, but part of your schedule. So I just witness wherever I go and stuff like that. But a buddy of mine in Atlanta, every Tuesday night in Atlanta, you can join a friend of mine, Chris. He takes a group out witnessing to Five Points downtown Atlanta. They go out from 6 to 9 every Tuesday night. And sometimes they'll have 20 or 30 people out there just walking the streets in Five Point talking to people about Jesus Christ. So it's set on the schedule every Tuesday, cold, hot, whatever. Okay, they're out there. So it's just so make it part of your schedule. Then you have time. Okay? Ask yourself the question, what is stealing your time? Because each one of us has the same 24 hours, right? So what's stealing your time? What's stealing our time most of the time? It's the gadgets that we have, right? I have a cell phone only because someone gave me one, and I have it in the off position most of my life. Some of you out here texting while I'm speaking, okay? Is that text really more important than this talk today? I'll be witnessing somebody, and all of a sudden they get the little ding from their phone, and they'll pull up to look at their phone real quick. I said, oh, excuse me, was that message more important than the conversation we were just having? You know, I'm willing to say direct things and do that, okay? Gadgets will kill you in 2014. So actually, does anyone know what an EMP bomb is? Who knows what it is? What is it? Electromagnetic pulse bomb. And so if it went off over Indianapolis, what would happen? Every piece of electronic, if it underneath the bomb, will not work. Okay? We have this bomb. Iran has this bomb. Russia has a bomb. China has this bomb. Every electronic underneath it won't work. Wow. Think about what wouldn't work. Okay? None of your phones would work. Your pads wouldn't work. Your computer would not work. Your car would not work, your refrigerator would not work. Just go through the list. A friend of mine who's got connection with the military, we have a couple underground bunkers, bases out of San Antonio that they're actually covered with copper. So if the EMP bomb ever goes off, they can still keep their electronics underneath it to run some of the nuclear weapons and stuff. Okay, this is real stuff. Okay, so again, why am I letting that... Aren't you glad Jesus didn't have a cell phone? Okay, because he's going past the woman at the well. He gets a text from the disciples. Hey, where's my food at? Oh, hey, fellas, okay, hurry up. I'm hungry. Jesus, hungry. Bring me some food. Thank you. And there was a lady right here that needed to hear from the Lord, and he just walked. We're living most of our life down. Watch people in airports. They're always down, looking down. People all the time, they're sitting in their whole life and got two earbuds in. Disconnected from the world. I was in the airport one time, and there was this interesting-looking guy with two earbuds in. So I sat down next to him, just stared at him. And then he said, hey, you look interesting. Can I ask you a question? He said, yeah. I said, when you die? I said, what do you think happens after death? What do you think happens? Other earbud came out, 30-minute conversation on the topic of God. He was a disc jockey at a club up in Philadelphia. Interesting guy. But if I don't get the earbuds out, you see, I don't get the conversation with the guy and do that. So sometimes we have to. So again, what's stealing your time? Take your time back. There's one fun thing of getting older. You understand how important time is. The older you get and do that, okay? All right, hands up. What holds you back from talking to everybody? What does?
I do witness all the time. We took a couple classes here in the church, and we'd go to the mall. We'd kind of like a week
Okay, so how do you talk to a family member about Jesus Christ? Okay, hold that. We'll do that during question and answer time and do that. But I'll give you a couple simple things that'll work perfect on that, okay? Anything else just hold us back from doing that? Okay, one of the things you worry about a little bit is, am I going to interrupt this person, okay? Let me ask you a question. Does Satan interrupt our lives all the time? All the time. You're going to a website, and here comes a pop-up for something you don't need to be seeing, okay? You go to, you know, you want to watch the Olympics, and boom, here comes the commercial right at you, pops up, okay? You're listening to, you know, some interview on TV, and someone drops a curse word in the middle of it, and he just interrupts your life all the time. There's nothing wrong with interrupting people's lives. I interrupt people's lives all the time, but it's a good interruption. It's a good interruption. Do you think the woman at the well is glad Jesus Christ interrupted her life? Yeah, not only did it lead to her, she went back and told a whole town. What's he even say later in John 4? The whole town came out to hear Jesus Christ. She was glad for the interruption. I just make sure it's a good interruption. I have talks to people all the time, 30-minute talks, sometimes an hour. They get up and shake me and thank you for stopping and talking with me. When I first started witnessing 20 years ago, I thought no one would ever do that. I didn't think anybody wanted to talk. I can't tell you how many people thank you for it. Because people to this day still enjoy a good conversation. They still do. Okay, so I just got to make sure it's an interesting conversation. Two ways to do that. One, ask good questions. Ask good questions. So if you ask good questions, it keeps people intrigued in, we'll teach some good questions in just a minute. It keeps them intrigued in the conversation. Okay, then always have something interesting to share with them. Do we have something interesting to share? Oh yeah, we do. Eternal salvation. By the way, if you could find out today exactly what happened the moment you took your last breath, would you want to find out? People say yes all the time to that question, because that's interesting. How do you know? I actually know somebody that came back from the dead. Really? Well, who is that? Well, who is that? That's Jesus Christ, yeah. You see, these little things like that can be so intriguing to somebody because they're searching. Again, what did we say this morning, second service? They have questions. We've got what? Answers. Okay, so that's why we want to talk to people and do that, okay? In the book, One Thing You Can't Do in Heaven, there's a chapter called, I don't know. And it's a really good chapter. I wrote it. And but it's how to break through the fear of rejection and do that, okay? So grab your Bibles, teach you something real simple. Go to Luke 6. Luke 6, and go to verse 22. Luke 6, 22. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you. I love this verse. Let's read it again. Blessed are you and men shall hate you. Don't you love the Bible? Do you have this one memorized? Do you have this verse memorized, just locked away? But again, don't read just a snippet of a verse. Matter of fact, that's how you get into false teaching. False teaching, every cult takes scripture and just twists it out of context is what they do to get you into false teaching, okay? So if you keep reading, blessed are you and men shall hate you. When they shall separate you from their company, shall reproach you. Cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. But remember, don't read a verse, read what? Verses, don't read a text, read what? Context, 23. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for behold, great is your reward in heaven. For in like manner did they fathers unto the prophets. First of all, they treated the prophets like this. They treated Paul like this, Peter like this, Thomas like this, okay? Do you read Hebrews 11 sometime, the Hall of Fame of Faith chapter, and you got people rejected, thrown to the lions because of their faith, sawn asunder. They would cut them in half with a saw. We're going to meet these people one day, okay? Hey, what was it like when you were on planet Earth? Well, gosh, you know, it was tough down here. I went to church one Sunday when it was raining one Sunday. I mean, it was raining hard, but it was heavy rain in Indiana. I mean, how are you going to talk to these people? I think about this at times. How are you going to talk to these people who are cut asunder for Jesus Christ, and we live to this day still in the easiest country to share your faith in Jesus Christ? Okay, now we're losing our rights. Big time. Getting interesting on the streets. Okay, we're losing it. All right, but we still have the easiest country to share Jesus Christ. Is that right? It is. They're making soldiers, when you go to Saudi Arabia, giving up your Bibles before you get in there. Can't bring your Bible into Saudi Arabia and stuff like that. Is it nice to know you can own a Bible here and read a Bible in America? Those days are changing. It'll be an outlawed book one day. In the United States of America, be an outlawed book. It would not shock me at all, the denigration they have for this book right now. Okay? It's still the easiest country, but we're losing those rights. Well, if I won't stand up when it's easy, what am I going to do when the tough days come? When it's going to cost me something. Okay? It's going to cost me big time and do that. Okay? Think about that. Okay? But they treat our prophecy. But he said, rejoice in that day if you're ever rejected. Leap for joy, for behold, great is your reward in heaven. So where are you storing up your treasures at? Remember, you're just passing through here. My newsletter, I actually write a newsletter each month, and there's a little sign-up sheet there, so just put your email on there. It's free. I'll put you into the system. We just send out a newsletter every month. And the one I wrote for January was just called Just Passing Through. It's all about, we're just passing through. Don't get too enamored with your stuff and your car and your house or your ticket to the Indy 500 or whatever, an IU-UK basketball game. Don't get too enamored with it. You're just passing through. Okay, you're heading to the other side where you're going to spend most of your time at. Might as well store your treasures up there than here, right? Yeah, okay, you're storing up your treasures in heaven? Let me tell you something. I work with a youth a lot around the country. I know some teenagers that are going to make a lot of us adults look like fools for Jesus Christ on reward day in heaven. There's some teenagers so radically sold out for Jesus Christ, it is crazy to watch some of these kids. But typically when you meet one of them, almost to their T, their mother and father are radical Christians for Jesus Christ. And it just flows right down into their kids below them. Okay, now it's not always that way, but that's real typical you see with a lot of these kids and stuff. Okay, they're going for it. I met a kid one day, you know, they do the sea at the pole, right? In September, they do the sea at the pole where all the kids are on the pole. He made a decision his senior year, he's going to see at the pole every single day his senior year. He showed up every single day, this senior did, to do see at the pole at his high school every single morning before school his entire senior year. He said, there were days I was the only one that was there. But I put my arms around the flagpole and I pray for my school. Every day his senior year. Whew, is that a stud or what? That's my kind of young man. I just was speaking in Iowa. And there was a young boy there, he was a wrestler. And I don't know if you heard last year in Iowa, but this one boy in the state tournament had to wrestle a girl in the Iowa state tournament. And if wrestling is race car is to Indiana, wrestling is to Iowa, okay? It's out of control, it's their sport in Iowa. And he had to, because they mixed the sport up, since there's not girls, but they allow girls in some schools to do this, okay? So he had to wrestle a girl in the state of Iowa, in the state tournament. Young boy said, no, I won't do it, okay? This young boy got vilified in the Iowa newspapers. It was a national news story. It was on foxnews.com. It was on like the Today Show. They interviewed him and his father, ripping this boy and his dad. Okay? It's a Christian family. I got to meet the boy. He was at something I spoke at just a few months ago in Iowa. He wouldn't do it. Do you know why? He said, I'm a Christian young man. He said, you don't touch ladies like that. You're not taught to touch a lady like that and wrestle a lady like that. You treat ladies like the special creations of the Most High God that they are. 1 Peter 3 type women, Proverbs 31 type women. That's how you treat ladies. This boy wasn't going to do it. Ripped him to shreds. So she got a walkover, right? He exited the tournament. Now, again, if you're a wrestler, everything is the state tournament. And then getting a scholarship to either Iowa or Iowa State. If you're in the state of Iowa, that's all you want, okay? He's a great wrestler, too. Complete. He didn't care. I told him, I said, I heard about your story down in Georgia. This kid spoke volumes, okay? You put your feet down, you stand for what's right, and God will honor that, will he not? Yes, he will, okay? And this kid loved the Lord. I spent a little time with him a few months ago when I was speaking, and just a wonderful kid, but he had been taught that way by his parents. And it ain't worth it. You do not treat girls like that, and you don't do that, okay? But see, we live in a society that's trying to make girls guys, and guys, what? Girls, you see? And God made them distinctly different, very important to know this, okay? And it's the total deception of our culture today, okay? Very much. When we let women into the service academies and stuff and things like that, okay? Because men, it's our job to be protectors of our wives and daughters, yes or no? Yes, that's what men are supposed to do, okay? I meet ladies all the time. They don't want to be guys. They want to be ladies. God made them that way, okay? But not in our culture today. Actually, my new book comes out in April, and I one of the characters, she goes to Yale University, and she takes women's studies. Be very careful of any women's studies program, okay? So the guy asked her, one of the guys, Leonardo, in the book, asked him, by the way, did they spell women's W-O-M-E-N-S? Or did they spell it W-O-M what? No, Y-N-S. You go to get on the internet, look up college courses at IU, and look up women's studies. They now spell it many times W-O-M-Y-N-S. Do you know why? They hate who? Men. So they misspell the men at the end of it to M-Y-N. I have been at colleges when I'm speaking. I go look, and I look, and there's on the board right there, W-O-M-Y-N-S, women's studies. I actually read an article from a guy who has stood very strong against the feminist movement. And all these ladies wrote him. And I read the letters from the ladies who are now 60 and 70 years old, okay? And they bought the feminist movement, okay? Well, now they got older. When you get older, you get to reevaluate things, don't you? Oh yeah, they began to reevaluate. Lady after lady, I bought the lie. I tried to be the CEO and conquer the business world. Now I'm older. I have no kids. Okay? I have no grandkids I can take out to lunch and spend time with. I've got nobody late in my life. I bought the lie. Do you know what some of these ladies write? They will tell you that feminism has brought our culture two things and two things only. You know what they'll tell you? What two things? What? Abortion and lesbianism. That's exactly right. Abortion and lesbianism. Because many people go into women's studies, the ladies will come out lesbians out of it all the time. Because they hate who? Men. Yeah. They're taught that. The literature they teach them. Okay? Be very careful sending your kids just to junior colleges. The worst classes in junior college are the English classes. The reason why is because the English teacher can typically pick any book to teach the English from. Okay? So they teach a book that's pro-homosexual. They teach a book that's anti-capitalist. They'll teach books from there, plant the seed in their head to get your kids to walk away from biblical truth. Okay? You have to understand this. This is a battleground going on right now. It's a fight. Well, you know what? Us men especially, a lot of us like a good fight. Okay? Like a good fight. Someone asked me if we ever beat Kentucky when I was in college. And we played them, I think, 11 times. We beat them twice. But my best game in college, my sophomore year, we beat Kentucky. They were number one in the country. And that was the best game I had in college, okay? I can remember that game like it's nothing. That's 30 years ago. It was 1982, so 32 years ago, goodness. And 32 years ago, okay? Why? It was a fight, okay? You didn't want to play Georgia State, Southern University of whatever city or whatever. You wanted to play UK, okay? You wanted to play IU, right? It's the big game. Because we like a good fight. Okay, our culture right now, men and ladies, we need to fight. We need to fight. We need to get back in the game a bit and get into a conversation and start chatting with people and do this stuff. Okay, and going to a college campus, walking, just sitting with somebody and chatting with them and stuff. Okay, get back in the fight. The lies they're being taught, I talked to a high school kid the other day. He's being taught that homosexuality, that you're born that way and there's no way you can change it. None. Taught that in high school. Okay, put this in your notes because you'll deal with the homosexual issue a ton before it's all said and done. Put this one in your notes. Does anyone know how to disprove that you're born homosexual? Anyone know how to disprove that? Anyone know how to disprove it? How would you disprove it? Okay, so you could show them a verse where homosexuals, they're offending to God, 1 Corinthians 6. Put that in your notes, 1 Corinthians 6. Has some good scriptures right there about homosexuality and God. But again, when most homosexuals, you talk with them, they don't believe what book to be true, the Bible, so that argument won't fly at first. It will fly usually a little bit later, but it will still fly, okay? And again, you always want to point verses out to them. We were at a gay festival one time witnessing. Actually, the DVD on the table, Pride Goes Before Destruction, you actually watch me witness to people. Actually, went out with a video camera one day. It's not real good high quality, but really cool conversations. And we went to a gay festival, and so you can watch me talk with people, okay? I do good at times. I fumble at times. God's bigger than my fumbles, right? I just was planting seeds, having a great time. But one lady, it's not on there, but one lady at the gay festival one time in Atlanta, she asked me, no, the Bible only talks about homosexuality. It never talks about lesbianism, so I'm actually okay. What an interesting statement from a homosexual lesbian at a gay festival. She said it to me. So I reached in my backpack, I pulled out my Bible. I went to Romans chapter 1. And Romans chapter 1 says that a woman will leave the natural use of a man to the unnatural use of a woman. And a man will leave the natural use of a woman to the unnatural use of another man. And I showed it to her. She says, it does talk about it. I said, yes, it is, Romans 1. She was blown away when I shared that with her. Okay, so that's why we got to know our scriptures, right? Yeah, and do that, okay? In the Bible, there's 12 or 13 verses about homosexuality, all said in the negative, do not do it, okay? There are over 200 verses in the Bible on heterosexual sin. God says, don't do it. Now, careful. Sometimes homosexuals think we're beating them up, right? We're Bible beaters hitting with the Bible and stuff. I said, no. I always tell them, I said, nope, God's much harsher against the heterosexual sin when you read the Bible front to back than he is. I said, I'm just as strong chatting with an adulterer, okay? Fornication before you're married. God only puts a stamp of approval on one thing. What's it? Don't say marriage. Much more specific. Man and woman in marriage. That's the only stamp of approval he puts. Nothing else does he put a stamp of approval. Not bestiality, not pedophilia, not fornication, adultery, homosexuality, nothing. Okay, so when I'm chatting with somebody, so your God's pretty much a party pooper for everything. I said, yeah, he cares about you though, okay, to make sure you do it within his bounds, his boundaries, okay, because he's a covenant relationship and he's trying to teach the covenant you're going to have to him. And plus we're the bride of Christ, and you don't want a bride that has been with everybody, because we have a word for that, don't we, that we call it. No one wants to hear that word if that's about you. You want a pure bride. I was just at the brewery place. I wasn't drinking. And fire something. Yeah, and in the next room over, there was a chalkboard, a bunch of ladies in there. I said something about love, so I walked in there, I'm crazy. I said, hey, how y'all doing? What is that? Oh, it's a quote from the Song of Solomon. I said, really? And it was a quote about love and a lady's getting married, okay? And so this was their whatever y'all do. And so they're having this little party there. I said, really? And then the lady says about the bride-to-be, oh, and she's kept herself for her husband. I'm like, seriously? And I said, thank you for that great testimony to share with young people that yes, you can keep yourself all the way to the marriage day, okay? You don't have to do what the world says to do when they're trying to, but think about it. If all they're trying to tell us is we're evolved animals, don't be shocked when people act like animals. If you don't think evolution's a big deal, you're thinking wrong, okay? If they teach you you're an evolved animal and people act like animals, it shouldn't shock you. Okay, and do that. How can you disprove someone's born that way? Very simple. One, I was sitting at a table 2 years ago, Rockmart, Georgia, a little country town in Georgia. I had 7 or 8 teenagers wanted to chat with me before this event that night. So we're sitting at a table. I just asked this one girl, senior in high school, by the way, what's the biggest sin your friends are dealing with in high school? She doesn't even hesitate. Lesbianism, doesn't even hesitate, from a small country school. Just think about that for a second. You folks with some age under your belt, how our culture's changed so much in a short time. I said, really? Yeah, everybody's trying it. But their teachers were born this way, boom, boom, boom. I said, okay. So I had some young men at the table, young black kid there. I said, are you black? He said, yeah. I said, could you ever not be black? He said, no, I'll always be black. He said, even if I put, clothes, I'm still black. I'm white. I'll always be white, okay? young boy at the table. I said, what color are your eyes? He said, I don't know, a typical boy. And so I asked his friends, what color? He said, brown. I said, could your eyes never not be brown? He said, no. He said, even if I put a blue contact, they would still be brown underneath, right? So the way to disprove you're born that way is if you could find one homosexual that ever lived in the gay lifestyle and left it to be in the heterosexual lifestyle. If you're going to find one of those people, you could disprove homosexuality is born that way, correct? Can you find one person that was in the lifestyle and left it, yes or no? Thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people have left it for the heterosexual lifestyle. That proves immediately it's not born that way. It's a behavior. Now, what's interesting is when you do the research, the studies, 98% of the people who leave it for a spiritual reason. Usually they get saved. They leave it. One of my friends, he was in that lifestyle. He slept with over 100 different guys, okay? Got saved, got married, got a wife and 3 kids, wonderful life now, and he goes back and now he reaches those people in that lifestyle to get them out of that lifestyle. The other 2%, they typically leave it because it's a very disease-filled lifestyle, and it's a very, if you have any friends that are in or family that are in, it's a very tough lifestyle because there's a lot of partners. It's not monogamous. The average gay male in America has between 300 and 500 partners in a lifetime. Think about that. Because testosterone plus testosterone does not work. That's why God was gracious to get testosterone plus estrogen. They work just fine. Okay, see, God designed it a perfect way to do that. Okay, the other way to disprove it. So you know the basketball player guy that came out, that Jason Collins, that's all the rage. He came out as homosexual. Let's celebrate this, okay? Well, there's a problem. The problem is twofold. One, he was engaged for 7 years to a lady. And she said she had no clue. If I'm white, can I hide that for 7 years to somebody? No. If I have blue eyes, can I hide that? No. If you can hide it for 7 years, you're not something. Okay? And plus, wouldn't that also prove he's bisexual and not homosexual? Another lie, they don't tell you that one as well. Okay? Other way to disprove it, he has a brother. Anyone know the relationship he has to his brother? Identical twins, that's exactly right. Identical twins. What do you know about identical twins? Exact same genes. So that means if one of them is homosexual, the other one has to be what? Homosexual. Is his brother homosexual? Nope, married to a lady for 3 or 4 years now. Okay? Total disproof. As they celebrate it, I tell homosexuals that Jason Collins is the worst person that could have come out in the gay world to say, I'm gay, look at me, we're born. He's the worst because he has an identical twin brother that's straight. Okay? It totally disproves your argument. And they don't even get it. They'll get it when you start talking to them. But the national news, they don't care. They have an agenda. They're trying to make you think a certain way. Does that make sense? Go to Daniel 11. Daniel 11. Now, if you like the book of Revelation, Daniel is the Old Testament version of Revelation. So it's right after what, Ezekiel? It's after Ezekiel. It's a very short book, 12, 13 chapters. And go to Daniel 11. Now, Daniel 11, many people think it's talking about the Antichrist here. Go to Daniel 11, go to verse 37. Daniel 11, verse 37. And many people think this whole section, we'll go to 36. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself, magnify above every god, shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that is to be determined and shall be done. 37. Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers. So many people think he'll be Jewish and disregard Abraham and Moses and David's God. Okay? Nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. He's basically going to claim to be God incarnate. We know from 2 Thessalonians 2, he's going to do miracles, lying signs and wonders, and you'll follow the signs and wonders and follow him afterwards. But Deuteronomy 13 it says, I, God, may send you someone to do signs and wonders right in front of you, just to test you. Does God send us tests? Yes or no? All the time. Just to test you, will you still follow me as God, or will you follow that miracle work, or will it lead you directly away from me? See, I already know Dr. Running 13, so if someone pops on the scene soon and we're still alive and I see miracles being done, whoops, guard's up. Put your guard up and test very quickly, okay? Because it's going to be somebody false, more than likely. Watch this. Nor the desire of women. I've always thought that meant the Antichrist would probably be single, maybe divorced, something like that. But now in 2014, now I'm beginning to think that the Antichrist might be what? Homosexual. Okay, and then he comes upon the scene and do that. Now, remember, before you could have a homosexual antichrist, you'd have to accept homosexuality first. Have we reached that point? Oh, we've reached that point. Matter of fact, the mayor of Paris is an open homosexual. So I have someone up to the mayor level that's open about this, okay? And now all of a sudden, the only people that are narrow-minded bigots are you people who think it's wrong, which is who? All of us. Yeah, and if they ever study this, but they don't because it's all turning against Christianity, we're nice to the homosexuals. Muslims aren't. They'll kill you. They will string you up and kill you, okay, for homosexuality, okay? A lot of these atheists, they just don't get it. They're blinded right now, but they should thank God they live around Christians or in a Christian-type country, because this stuff they're trying to push would not fly in any of these Muslim countries and do that. They should be thankful, and they're not. Okay, so we want to keep telling about this God and this Jesus Christ. They can be thankful for that, okay? But tuck that away. Daniel 11:37 may come into play and do that. Number one's want to. Number two's afraid to. I don't have to be afraid to if great is my reward in heaven, right? Number three is how to. So let's teach a couple how to's. Then we'll do some questions, okay? First one. Remember we said last time, sharing your faith isn't a presentation. It's a what? Conversation. So you're just talking with people. But talking with people implies you're asking questions. So be careful in a conversation. I present things during conversations, but I'm talking with people. Every atheist you talk to is a completely different conversation. Matter of fact, every homosexual you talk to is completely different. Many of them get into it because the three main reasons people go into homosexuality, one, there's a break in the same-sex relationship to the same-sex parent. So dad to son, mom to daughter, there's a break there. Dad's a truck driver, always gone. Divorce. You meet a lot of gay men that grew up with just their mom and their sisters. Had no strong male influence in their life. Went a little bit more feminine, Satan said, thank you, made a move, okay? Two, sometimes there's an early experimentation in the sexual world in eighth or ninth grade. Oops, I touched my friend, I must be gay. Nope, you just touched somebody. It's not anything more than that, but Satan doesn't care. But the third one that's huge, huge, and beyond huge, is molestation. Okay, many homosexuals were molested as a kid. Melissa Etheridge, the famous rock and roll guitarist, she said publicly on a TV show, publicly, that she was molested over and over and over again by one of her uncles when she was a young kid. Gender confusion, Satan says thank you, makes a move and hooks somebody and walks them away. Many lesbians will also tell you they had such bad guy relationships. Guys would get physical, punch them. I had a lesbian lady one day at the gay festival I was witnessing to her. She said her boyfriend used to take his cigarettes and put them out on her. Okay? So the lady says, wait a minute. Guys treat me that way. I bet a lady treats me better than that. And then they go down that road. And they don't realize all the dead ends at that road. Fellas, how you treat ladies is extremely important, correct, fellas? Yeah, I speak at men's conferences. I do things where they're just teenage boys. I speak. Yeah, you can push a girl into lesbianism by how you treat them, okay? And seriously, it's just, but they're very honest. They will tell you why something's happening in their life, okay? So ask questions, talk to them, get into those conversations. They'll tell you why, then you can go minister the issue. So when you talk to a homosexual person, I don't bring up the topic until they bring it up. Because you don't die and go to hell because of homosexuality. You die and go to hell because you broke the laws, the commands of God. You're expressing it that way is the issue. Okay, it's not the bane issue, it's the heart issue. They have a broken heart. Especially the ones who were molested as a kid. Oh, they're shattered. They're shattered. What do they need? A new heart. Hey, don't we have the answer for that one? Yeah, God will take out the heart of stone, put in the heart of flesh. You're a new creation, 2 Corinthians 5, with the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to give them the information to get the new heart from the Most High God, okay? So have the conversation. Get people on their favorite subject. What's their favorite subject? Themselves. Hey, where are you from? What do you do? Where do you go to school? What's your favorite sport? easy conversations, just easy, simple things to get people talking. If you had 2 hours of free time, you could do anything on planet Earth, what would you do? That's a great question. I ask that all the time. Just, you know, if you had 2 hours, you can do anything on planet Earth, what would you do? Okay, you get people's interests up real quick. If you could have any job on planet Earth and money wasn't the issue, what would you do? Ooh, now you're finding out what people love. Okay, so just good questions that get you going like that, okay? And that gets them talking and talking about themselves and do that, okay? Let's give you a couple good starter questions, then we'll take some questions here, okay? In the book, The Watchmen, there's a chapter called Reaching the Lost Now that has a bunch of these starter questions in there, and a bunch I'm not gonna get to, so that's just a good book for you to go through and do that. Good question, if you die tonight, are you 100% assured you go to heaven? That's a good question. If you die tonight, are you 100% assured you go to heaven? It's a good question if you don't have a long time, okay? My waitress today, she was busy. She had a lot of tables. I ended up asking a different question, but I almost asked this question because I saw how busy she was, and I looked at my watch. I was a little late getting here, so I needed to go ahead and make a move quick. So if you don't have a lot of time, like it's the cashier lady at a store, and you have five people behind you in line, you are not gonna have a long conversation. It's just not gonna happen. She's working. So I ask a very direct question. Hey, can I ask an interesting question? Easy hook. I do that all the time. Can I ask an interesting question? What's everybody say? Sure, what do you got? If you die tonight, are you 100% assured you go to heaven? Okay, now, when you get that, many times they're gonna give you a number back. I'm 90% sure. Okay. Now, if you ever get that, just go with, hey, what's the 10% that's holding you back? Now, if you're not good at math, don't say, hey, what's the 25% holding you back? Don't do that, because you're going to look really foolish. Okay, so be careful. But just throw the number back at them. What's the 10% holding you back? Bingo. They'll start telling you some sin they're involved in, okay? And that's holding them back from doing that, okay? So it's a great question. I think I told the story last time, but I was at going through a toll booth. You have toll booths up here in Indiana? Okay, so don't get the easy pass thing because it makes it easy to pass by the people in the other booths you need to talk to. Okay, so I would never get an easy pass. Go to the booth. It takes a little bit more time, but isn't that person worth the time? So I'm in this booth. I flew into Philadelphia and I'm trying to get over to Maryland to speak. So I had to cut through Delaware, and Delaware's all toll booths in Delaware. Pull up to this, say, hey, how you doing? Great. How much do I owe you? Great. Hey, I said, can I ask you an interesting question? She said, yeah. I said, if you die tonight, are you 100% assured you go to heaven? She said, no, real quick. I said, do you believe in a heaven? She said, yes. Oops, do you have a problem already? You believe there's a heaven and you're not sure you're going there? If you believe in heaven, wouldn't you make sure you've checked every box to make sure you were doing whatever it took to go there? It sure makes sense, doesn't it, okay? I said, really? I said, do you know how to get to heaven? She said, no, I don't. I said, it's real simple. Let me explain it to you. Bingo. Just started walking through sin, repentance, cross. She had sunglasses on. She took the sunglasses, put them up on her head so she could look in my eyes. Now, real important, when we're on the streets, I don't wear sunglasses. I wear hats instead so you can see their eyes. They want to see your eyes because your eyes tell if you're serious about something. Same for them. Now, I can't tell them to take their glasses off, but sometimes people's mouth says, I'm not interested. Their eyes and their whole face, they keep talking. I'm soaking up everything you have to say. You know what I'm saying? So you're looking for the counts, but you want to make sure they can see your eyes as well. They know you're serious about this, okay? And all of a sudden, I looked in my rearview mirror, and no cars came in my lane. Okay, it was like there was a blockade at the stop, and no one could get there. So me and this lady had a wonderful conversation, okay? So again, if you don't have a lot of time, use that as your question. When you die, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out of here? This is probably my favorite question. So when you die, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out of here? Okay, so it's an open-ended question. So you're not gonna get a yes or no to this. Okay, so when you die, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there? That's the question I told you 2 years ago. That's the question I asked Tiger Woods one time. I was walking on the golf course with Tiger. I said, Tiger, I always wanted to ask you a question. He said, go for it. I said, Tiger, I said, when you die, I said, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out of here? He stopped dead square in his tracks, stared at me and said, I don't know. And we struck up a 10 to 12 minute conversation on the topic of God. Okay, so real simple. That's why that's a good open-ended question. That's what I asked my waitress today. I said, Wendy, I said, I want to ask you an interesting question. She said, okay. I said, Wendy, when you die, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out of here? She said, oh, she said, heaven. Okay, I said, do you believe there's a hell? She said, oh, definitely. I said, okay, what do you think separates who goes to heaven or who goes to hell? Okay, I'm looking for what answer? Jesus. She looked at me and said, purgatory. Whoa. Now, of course, as soon as you get that, you know what religion? Catholic, immediately, okay? I've never had that answer before. So even I got a little thrown today when that happened, because if you're that far into it, you're not gonna, because they believe that's what would separate hell and heaven, be physically purgatory, okay? And it was a very interesting answer. But she said, hey, I've just started going back to church. I'm not one of those serious Catholics or nothing like that, okay, you know? And so I just asked a simple question, and I didn't get it with her because of a time issue, but I would just ask, if you could skip purgatory, and I've done this numerous times, if you could skip purgatory and go right to heaven, would that be good news? They always say what? Sure. I said, do you know how to do that? And either they'll say being a good person, or they'll say no, and then you can just explain to them repentance, cross, a direct shot there. I don't have to stop there. And that's one of the things that finally got me when I was Catholic back in the day. One of the popes died, and they were plastering posters all over telephone poles around Rome. And I said, pray for the repose of the soul of Pope whatever to get him out of purgatory. Okay? I'm just, teenagers, maybe early 20s. I said, wait a minute. If the main guy didn't get to the heaven, what is this kid here? Don't stand a chance. I mean, there's no way, okay? And it was one of those aha moments that something can't be right here. And that's what hit me when they would actually put the posters up there for you. But if you ever study purgatory, it's an invented doctrine. We go through it in the Paradise book. It's an invented doctrine. The 1400s or something like that, invented, okay? So your relative Aunt Susie went to purgatory. Now, if you want to get out of there quicker, you have to buy what? An indulgence, okay? And you buy these, which help get her quicker out of purgatory. So when you're ever in a Catholic church, you hear people, they said the Mass in the name of somebody. Someone paid $50 or $100 to get the Mass said in their name. That helped them get out of purgatory quicker. They took all of the money and built the Vatican in Rome with the money from indulgences. That's a pyramid scheme, deception, a lie, because it had to do with someone's soul. That's wicked. That's evil stuff to do that, and that's exactly what it is, okay? And so you just walk, so I love this question. When you die, what do you think's on the other side? Very open-ended. Another thing I'll do, I'll have a little yellow stick pad in my hand, and I'll just do little surveys. So if you see me in malls, I use this sometimes in a mall, bar section of town, definitely. College camps, I'll walk on a little stick pad. Hey, how you doing? Great. Hey, can you help me out? I'm working on a project. People say, sure, what do you got? I like that word better than survey, okay? Because survey can have a different connotation. I'm working on a project. Sure, what do you got? Today I'm asking the question, when you die, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there when you walk out? People go, I love that question. Okay, bingo. I said, okay, what do you think? They give an answer. Mark their answer down. Heaven and hell, heaven and no hell, reincarnation, nothing. Mark it down. Hey, why do you believe that? Bingo, you're just out chatting and doing this. I spoke in, a little over 2 years ago, I spoke in South Bend, Indiana. Okay, speaking at a Christian college. But there's another college there too. What's that college? Yeah, Notre Dame. So I went there, I flew in earlier that day so I could go to campus. I walked around Notre Dame for 3.5 hours. To witness to students about Jesus Christ, okay? And I do this little survey approach just to get started. So it gets me where I want to go quicker, because I know I'm not going to be there for a long time. I can't even tell you the conversations I had with college students just over a little survey approach, okay? They tell you what they believe quickly. And so then you begin to chop through their arguments, okay, and give them truth and do that, okay? So again, real simple, but when you die, what do you think's on the other side? What do you think's out there, okay? Use things around you to get into conversations, okay? T-shirt, necklaces, jewelry, tattoo, anything you're wearing, I can use to get into a conversation, okay? So always looking for things. So if you ever watch me, I'm out and about, my eyes are always kind of moving a little bit because I'm actually looking, I'm reading people's hats, I'm reading people's shirts, okay? And I'm trying to find something that I know I can use to get into something and do a conversation. So you're looking for that. The rubber bracelets, you've seen, you know, the rubber bracelets, everyone, the Live Strong bracelets and things, okay. Those bracelets, I saw your bracelet, what do they stand for? You know, probably 50% of all bracelets have to do with some sort of death of something, okay. I'm at Notre Dame, and these three boys were throwing football. It was a college game day up there in a couple days. So these boys were throwing a football. So one of the boys, he pointed to me like he's going to throw the football. And he throws the football to me. Okay, I'm just walking around campus with my hat on and stuff. Did I catch it? No, I dropped it. It's the wrong shape. Have you seen a football? It's like this, and a basketball's round. And I dropped it, dropped straight to the ground, and the college boys were laughing. So they walked over. I said, hey, what are you guys, where are you guys from and stuff? I said, what are you studying? And this boy had bracelets on. I said, hey, what are your bracelets for? He said, this is for a high school friend of mine that committed suicide. This is for a college friend of mine, a high school friend who went off to college. He went to spring break in Florida, fell over the balcony and died. This is for, did we have a talk? Yeah, 30-minute conversation on the topic of God. Okay, those three boys opened up and talked, okay, but I just used the bracelet. Does that make sense? So I'm always looking for things around you. Hey, what's your favorite tattoo? I had a lady in the airport the other day. She only had one tattoo, and it was on her arm here, and it was a cross with some roses around it. I said, excuse me. I said, I was looking at your tattoo. I said, what is that for? She said, oh, my grandparents died. I just love my grandparents. I just love them. And I said, I noticed the cross. Why the cross? Said, oh, they were just big Christians, loved Jesus. Now, I'm not into that, okay, but they just loved it. I did it for them. Okay, so did we talk? Yeah, because grandma wants to see you. Granddad wants to see you one day on the other side, but you need that cross to get where you want to go. Okay, so I just used her tattoo to go where I wanted to go. In the train yesterday going to the Atlanta airport, there was a guy, he walked on, he sat across from me. He was wearing a Muslim cap. Okay, you've seen the caps Muslims wear? It's not a baseball cap, it's just a round one on their head. Now, if you see a turban on someone's head, okay, what religion is that going to be? That's Sikh, S-I-K-H, Sikh. Very, very different. Don't assume that's a Muslim. You're going to be 100% wrong. I wrote it in one of my books. I met a Sikh in the Atlanta airport one day, and I said, where's your turban? Asked the guy at the Indian restaurant last night. He had a turban. I said, where's your sword? Pulls it back. They always carry a sword with them as well. Okay. And so I said, where's your sword? He showed it to me. And so I had this Sikh in the airport. He didn't have a turban. I said, where's your turban? He said, no, don't wear it. I said, why? He said, on 9/12, the day after 9/11 in 2001, he said somebody walked up to him and pulled a gun on him. Because they assumed he was a what? A Muslim. And just started ripping at him, ripping at his faith and stuff. Completely wrong, it was a Sikh. So the guy does not wear his turban, okay, because he didn't want people to think he was a Muslim. Isn't that interesting? Very interesting. Up in Maryville, I always go to this one, what is it? The Middle Eastern restaurant, Lebanese restaurant. And after 9/11, the owner of the restaurant was shot and killed. Muslim guy. Okay, so every time I go in there, when I speak up there, I always go to this restaurant because I really like talking. They always remember me when I come in. And we always have the neatest talks about God and Jesus Christ and forgiveness. Because, fellas, you got to forgive this man or you're going to be held back your whole life of living your life and doing that, okay? And so we just get in these conversations and do that, okay? So I had the guy sitting across, and he had a Muslim cap on, but he had two earbuds in. Okay, so I can't talk to him. So he was just looking, so I just kind of pointed at him. And all of a sudden, his head turns on. I just pointed, just kind of nodded, and he took an earbud out. I said, Muslim? He said, yeah. I said, what branch? Sunni, Shiite, what branch? All of a sudden, he took the other one out. And he said, Nation of Islam. I said, okay. I said, Louis Farrakhan, Malcolm X? He said, yeah. I said, you know, I said, yeah, I study this stuff. I'm interested in this stuff. I said, what's the biggest difference between Nation of Islam and Sunni or Shiites? Bingo, he begins to talk, and he's talking, we're talking back and forth. Then he looks at me and says, by the way, when I read all this religious, you know, Islamic literature, I just pick what works for me. Ooh, interesting. I call it the buffet approach to religion. Pick this up. Oh, I like that. Whoops, holiness. Nope, let's put that one back. I don't want nothing to do with that. Okay. We kind of pick and choose. You can't pick and choose with God. God is God. His word is his word. You have to go by it. Okay. I said, no, no. I said, you're not looking for truth. You're searching for just what works for you? He said, yeah, I'm looking for what works for me. See, what's interesting, that's absolute truth versus what? Relative truth, more relative, which is the big kicker right now, okay? Because what works for you today may not work for you next week. And I always remind people, and if it doesn't work for you the day you die, it never worked, right? So you can use that. See, it was very easy to go. He loves to read, gave him paradise, and he shook my hand. Edward was his name. He shook my hand yesterday in China, and he said, I'll be in touch with you. I said, okay, do that. He said, I love the conversation, thank you. So you might have thought, Nation of Islam, they can be kind of radical Muslims sometimes out of Chicago with Louis Farrakhan. And he said, I'm not one of the ones that hates whitey or hates Jews and stuff, because that's really Louis Farrakhan, okay? He said, I'm not one of those, okay? And so we had this great time. But if I let the Muslim, he probably wouldn't want to talk with me. How do you know that? Okay, get into the conversation, see what happens, okay? But yesterday before I left my house, I stood at my door and I prayed for who? Who? Bob. I said, God, when I cross this threshold, today, give me a burden for these people. Give me a burden for these people. Put me on the right train, the right car, next to the right people on the way to the airport. Father, give me an opportunity. Put the right person next to me on a plane flight. Father, give me that boldness. And when I put my head on a pillow in Indianapolis, if you let me, Father, show me why I was alive today. Make sure for your glory and not mine. Boom, I step outside and then just see how the day went and did that, okay? So I'm just looking for opportunities as I do this. So when I'm talking to Edward on the train, no big deal. None of these surprise me anymore, because I just see how God works through time and do that, okay? Then last thing, and then we'll do question, answer. Always have gospel tracks. So we put some tracks on the table for you. Those are free for you. Our ministry's starting to make gospel tracks. They'll be on the website in probably 3 weeks. These aren't even out yet. You're some of the first people ever to see these gospel tracks. So when I went up to Kanye West and his group in Atlanta, I walked up to the hotel to meet a friend for lunch. As I walk up there, Kanye West is standing from the hotel with his posse. Okay, there's about six of them there. So I had to make a decision. Do I walk towards Mr. West, or do I walk towards my friend and meet him right on time for lunch? Which direction did I walk? Yeah, towards Kanye and his group. Now as I'm walking, am I getting nervous? Yeah, I can feel my heart begin to race. Sometimes little beads of sweat come up. Okay, that's okay. My high school coach used to shake our hands before games in the locker room. I'm like, Coach, what are you doing? I finally, you know, kids were crazy. I said, what are you doing? I'm trying to see if you're ready for the game. How in the world can you tell by shaking my hand if I'm ready for the game? He said, if I shake your hand, you know, at least a little bit sweaty, you're not even interested or excited what's about to happen. If it's all cold, you're not ready to play tonight. You got to get up for these things, okay, and get up for the big game, okay? Same thing. I don't worry about getting nervous. Put this in your notes. Make sure you let your love of God trump your fear of man. Very simple statement. Let your love of God trump your fear of man. I still deal with fear of men issues. I still want people to like me. We're human. I'm wrapped in flesh. It'll probably never change, okay? But I have to make sure my love of God trumps my fear of man. Does that make sense? Okay, very simple, okay? And so I had gospel tracts with me. So I walked up the group. Hey, did you guys get one of these? Now, don't say, would you like one of these? Too easy to say what? No. Hey, did you get one of these, okay? So my car at home, where I'm parked at, my backpack's in there with some clothes, and my backpack's full of tracks, because tomorrow night at 8 o'clock in Atlanta, the Eagles are playing, okay? And it'll be a sold-out show at Phillips, and so if I get back in time, if I have energy, I'm meeting my friends downtown tomorrow night to hand out gospel tracks to people walking in the concert, okay? And to talk with people. We've got booklets. We got my backpack's all ready to roll, okay? Because God uses gospel tracks. I handed the gospel to Kanye's group. One guy said, what is that? I said, it's a ticket to heaven. One guy said, I need one of those. I said, do you believe there's a heaven? He said, yep, I believe there's a hell. Yep, 15-minute conversation just like that. I'm speaking at a high school in Louisville. I'm on stage playing with these what-if cards in my hand. I get nervous, so I'll play with things. I'm just playing with these cards. I finish, a girl walks up to me. She said, excuse me, were you in front of Phillips Arena 3 or 4 months ago for a Coldplay concert in Atlanta, yes or no? I said, yeah, we were out there handing gospel tracks. I said, why? I said, my boyfriend was with me, and someone handed him one of these what-if tracks, okay? He stood there in that concert and read that track over and over and over again. He said those little questions on the back were just drilling his head, okay? Does God use gospel tracks, yes or no? All the time. All the time. So that's why we hand them out and things like that. You know, so there's some over there for you and do that. Then the last thing is, when you're talking to somebody, and then we'll do some questions here. When you're talking, if you ever get stuck, now will you get stuck? Yeah, you get stuck in a conversation. So a very easy way to get unstuck, ask a very simple question. Would you consider yourself a good person? Okay? Would you consider yourself a good person? 9 out of 10 people say what? Yes, okay? Then all paradise and the watchman both show you whenever you get the good argument, or if they don't know what sin is, go right to the Ten Commandments. Just walk them straight through the Ten Commandments. I walked Tiger Woods through the Ten Commandments. I walked Kanye West through the Ten Commandments, okay? Because one thing I wrote in one of the books, Make sure you get them lost before you get them saved. Right? We just want everyone to read three sentences off the back of a piece of paper and think they're saved. That's not biblical salvation. I had a 15-year-old boy tell me one time, "Sir, I prayed that prayer 12 different times." He thought it was magic prayer that was going to change his life. No, no, no. You repent and believe, the Bible says. Acts chapter 20, repent unto God and believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? It's an action you take to do that. So you just walk them through the Ten Commandments. Hey, you ever told a lie before? Sure. What's that make you? Okay, a liar. Well, sometimes they'll say human or sinner. More specific, if you murder, you're a murderer. Rape, you're a rapist. If you tell a lie, be a what? Like, let them say liar. I've seen whole people's whole countenance change when they have to admit they're a liar. Ever stole something before? Yep. What's it make you? A thief. Ever lusted in your heart before? Yeah. Jesus said even looking upon a woman with lust is the same as committing adultery in your heart. I have people, God's going to judge us on that? Yeah. Ever take the Lord's name in vain? Yeah, that's blasphemy. And how many times you watch these coaches on TV, right? Take JC and GD as curse words. But Joakim Noah, the basketball player for the Chicago Bulls, were playing the Heat one time. He got mad at someone in the stands and yelled out the word faggot to that guy. Okay, and the NBA fined him $50,000 for saying faggot. But every single day, they mock the name of God and Jesus Christ, and you're not fined a nickel. See the world we live in today? We live in a crazy world today, okay? That's blasphemy. Ever been angry with someone before? Yeah, Jesus said anger without cause is the same as committing murder in your heart. So you just told me by God's standard, keep pointing to God, okay? Keep pointing to the cross. Pastor Wayne was so right about that today, okay? By God's standard, you'd be a liar, a thief, blasphemer, adulterer, and a murderer. Would you be guilty or not guilty on judgment day? Let them speak. They usually say what? Guilty. I said, would that mean heaven or would that mean hell? Most people look at me and will say hell. Then I asked the question, I asked this to Kanye West. I said, does it bother you that you'd be going to hell? He looked at me and said what? Yes, it does. Very honest answer. Yes, it does. I said, do you know what it takes to make sure you don't go to hell? He said, no, I don't. Explain repentance, the cross, resurrection. You just walk them. Galatians 3 says the law carry you onto the cross. They've heard the cross. Many of the rappers wear the Jesus face, you know, jewelry. They wear the crosses and stuff. They just don't know why the cross, okay? Use the law to carry them to the biblical cross and do that. Okay, and so that's where you just walk them right through the law and do that. Okay, hands up. What are certain questions you've got? How to witness to a certain type of person? Question you're afraid to get, or maybe a question you've had you couldn't answer. Now, just remember this. When you ask me a question, if I don't know the answer, what will I say? I don't know. That's an okay answer in a conversation. So remember, when you're talking on the streets, talking with a friend over lunch, talking at the mall, if you don't know an answer, whatever you do, do not create an answer on the spot. If you do, you'll get in more trouble at this point than you know what to do with. If you don't know, just say, that's a great question, I don't know. Doesn't mean there's still not a God. Doesn't still mean the Bible's not true. Just because I don't know everything, I can't know everything. I'm not God. Okay, now, always have something to write with. We taught my students this all the time. What you do is then say, hey, would you like to know the answer to that question? They always go, sure. Okay, hey, what's your email or what's your phone number to text an answer to? And I'm going to put it down here and I'll get you an answer. My eighth grade students would come back on Mondays, raise their hand. As soon as I walk into class, raise their hand. Mr. Cahill, I was witnessing this weekend. How do you answer this question? Eighth graders, 13 and 14, witnessing on the weekends, and wanted to know answers to questions. Think about that for a second. That's powerful, okay? Now, when you get back in touch with them with an answer, does that mean anything to that person? Because out of your time, you just spent time out of your 24 hours to go find them an answer. That means a lot to people, okay? If you don't know an answer, say, I don't know. That's okay, and keep on trucking. Don't stop there and do that, okay? All right, hands up. What are questions?